Box Tools. I'm Tom. So it's time for another Meatloaf, guys. I got a really neat collection of some really interesting tools and viewer appreciation gifts. Some really interesting books with World War II history, which is really neat. We got old pictures, some eBay stuff. It's going to be great. Okay, so let's take a look at some of this stuff close up and have some fun. All right, let's do some history first. This is a really neat picture. This was sent to me by a gentleman named Ken Dahl, and he's in Helena, Oklahoma. And I don't know quite where he ran across this picture, but he thought it was pretty cool. And he thought it was from a place called Salida, Colorado. And it very well may be from Salida, Colorado, but there's some, impressions in the original picture or the framing or whatnot that leads me to believe that this came from Charles City, Iowa. Okay, so I have no way of telling if it was from Salida or Charles City, but it's still cool no matter what. What's interesting is dating this picture. Now, I'm hoping for a little bit of help from you guys out there in internet land. And take a look at this lathe here. I haven't been able to identify this lathe, so I'm hoping somebody out there may have one or can find a picture of one. And let me point out a couple of things that are kind of distinctive about this particular lathe. One is this, the lead screw mount here. Typically these come off of the bed, but this one seems to emanate from part of the foot, which is kind of unique, I think. And then the other thing is, the carriage has kind of square corners on it. Okay, so anyway, if anybody can identify that lathe, I think that might help us date this picture. There's a couple other things that I'll point out in this picture that are just, you know, it's just kind of a neat old picture. So first is check out the hat. Now this looks like a military hat, possibly Civil War, and now I don't think this image is from the Civil War because we have an electric light here and with a handmade, shop-made shade there, and there's a wire going up there, which is kind of neat. So, you know, this is, you know, maybe after 1880, something like that, but no telling when. So a couple other things. Here's some change gears for the lathe, which are kind of neat. So there you can see one that's on the machine, but these are the spare gears to change for threading and whatnot. Okay, looks like you might be doing some cast iron from the chips. And then we have these over here. This is cool because somewhere else in the shop they have a horizontal mill that uses these supports for the mill, which is kind of neat. And then the other thing that struck me is just look how greasy his coveralls are. They're so greasy that they're shiny, okay? So that's when you know you're greasy, is when you're shiny. Okay, and there's his tools there. He's got some calipers and looks like a pair of dividers in there or something like that. Anyway, just kind of a neat picture. And Ken, thanks for sending that in. That's pretty cool with, you know, from a historical standpoint. And, you know, who knows? This guy, he might be 16, 18 years old or whatever, right? So he looks pretty young in the picture and in his greasy coverall. So, Ken, thank you very much for sending that in. Okay, so this next one's pretty neat, too. Now, I've shown this book before, I think. Not this particular one, but this is actually a fairly common book. You see a fair number of copies of this around. What's more interesting is who owned this book, okay? And this was sent in by Dave Weaver. And Dave, thanks for sending this in with he sent in a bunch of notes too with it. He'd seen a interview online with the guy that owned this book. And so he gave me some cheat notes here. Now let's take a look at this here. We're gonna open the cover. And here's the guy's name, okay? And it's Louis Fasulo, okay? And he got this book, or he wrote in this book in 1948, I think, is 48, I don't know, that might not be an 8, I don't know, it seems like it would be earlier than that when he had this book. I don't know what that number is. It sort of looks like an 8, could be a 5, I don't know. Anyway, so it's Louis Fasulo. Now, you know, the book is, it's the Henry Ford, you know, trade book, which is kind of cool, teaches you how to be a machinist, okay? But here's what's cool, okay, is Louis worked on the Manhattan Project, okay? And there's Louis right there, and he's in some pretty powerful company there in this picture. If you look there, there's Enrico Fermi and Richard Feynman. Okay, so he's in the F, so that's where he shows up in the ID thing. So Louis was a machinist on the Manhattan Project. So we don't know what he worked on, but it took him weeks to get his security clearance, and then he worked in Los Alamos. In fact, on this picture, it says Los Alamos, on the signature, it says Los Alamos. So now apparently there's an interview in the Manhattan Project History Archives. There's an interview with him, with this gentleman online. I haven't looked at it yet, but I'm going to when I get a minute. And it's pretty neat. So he got his tool and die apprenticeship at Ford, and then he got called out to for a secret project out in New Mexico, and anyway, he met his wife out there, and I guess she was the gatekeeper. He had to go through the gate every day, and he met his wife there, and he worked in what's called the C shop, which I have no idea what that is, some letter designation for, you know, I don't know, who knows what C stood for. And then after World War II, he moved to Idaho and went to Rocky Flats, which is another national lab. Actually, is that a national lab? I'm not sure what Rocky Flats is. But anyway, it's you know, they do Department of Defense work out there. So anyway, it's kind of cool. So this is kind of a neat piece of history. So Dave, thank you very much for sending this in. And this is, you know, how we make our connection with the people that that came before us, right? And it's just really neat. You know, this guy might have machined plutonium or high explosives, or who knows? They could have just been bracketry for you know, who knows what. So anyway, just kind of a neat piece of history there. All right. So these next two items here, these are eBay finds. There wasn't a lot of stuff that was kind of obscure, I guess I would call it, and they were kind of listed in a funny way, so I don't think they attracted a lot of attention. Anyway, I've been wanting one of these, and I'll tell you what this is in a sec, and part of that lot was this guy here, which is pretty cool, actually, so we'll talk about both pieces. This is a let's start with that one here. This is a Pratt & Whitney Toolmakers flat is what this is. So this is a it's a very, very, very flat disc and parallel too. It's parallel, and it's actually, I'm going to grab something in a sec here and we'll demonstrate it. But this is so flat and so smooth that you can actually ring gauge blocks to this. And that was the idea, is you ring gauge blocks to this and you use this for little measuring jobs and little checking gauges and setting things up. So it was like a steel surface plate that you can actually ring gauge blocks to and have a little more area to work with and be assured that this is nice and flat. Now it's pitted a little bit, but it's still extremely flat. I checked it with my an optical flat and my monochromatic light, and it is extremely flat. In fact, it's better than my optical flat is, okay? And even though it looks a little funky, so but we're going to show that a little bit more in just a second. All right. So we got this is a 1-inch Minutoyo gauge block here. And let's see if we can get this thing to ring. I did it before. Yeah, it feels like it's going. So let's see. Pretty good, huh? So it's still pretty good, even with, you know, this staining and whatnot. The gauge block rings right to it. Now, I don't think I can get the gauge block to ring to it in that stained area, but like I said, it's still extremely flat, which is pretty cool, right? that phenomena is just fascinating. Anyway, oop, there, popped it loose. That phenomena is just fascinating for nerds like myself. So anyway, pretty cool. So Pratt and Whitney Toolmakers flat. You see them every once in a while, and they're in varying conditions. Oh yeah, and this one belonged to a guy named Jay Bajarski. It's got his name in it right there. And this was probably a pretty expensive piece of kit back in the day. And I don't have a Pratt & Whitney catalog that shows these. This is a 5-388, and I think it's 5-inch diameter. Yeah, 5-inch diameter. I don't know when they stopped making these, so maybe somebody out there has a Pratt & Whitney catalog that shows these. I'm guessing that they stopped making these in the 40s or 50s or maybe later than that. I don't know. Let's take a look at this next. Okay, so this next one here was part of the same eBay lot, or same buyer, or same seller, I should say. I got this piece from. Anyway, this was listed. It had a picture of it, and it was listed as, and I'll take this out here because this is a kind of part of the story. It was listed as a Stanley metal angle or something like that. And what was in it was this little, you know, it's some kind of die, and it says Stanley in it, right? So they said, oh, this must be Stanley brand or something like that. Well, that is just not the case here, okay? Now, this is kind of a cool bonus to get with it, is it's a punch used for imprinting Stanley tools is what it looks like. So this gentleman, Eric, whoever he is, might have worked for Stanley at some point. But I think what's going on here is he had this in here just to keep this keeper. Okay, so you got this end keeper here, and I think it was just so he didn't lose track of that, and he kept that tight so that they wouldn't wander off. And this is one of the really neat features of this thing here. And I'll show you what this is for in just a sec. But look what they did. You know, we were talking about style points the other day, right? And here he had the end of this thing. It's big, it's wide. What do you do with it, right? Well, he did. Actually, this is a very elegant touch here. Let me make sure I'm not jumping out of the frame there. So what he did was he took a ball end mill, and he just kind of came around here with a radius and cut some of that material away, and it's sweet. It's just a really nice touch how he did that, right? So what this is, and you can't talk about this without this in the picture here, and I don't have a loose one, but what this is it's a radius dresser for surface grinder wheels, okay? And let's pretend this is a diamond here, okay? And then we have a diamond here. Well, the way this works is this pops in like so, okay, and now, make sure I'm in the picture, now we know what the center of rotation of this is. Actually, it's adjustable, and so we can set the height of the diamond, and now we can rotate through an arc, and this has a thing for putting stops on it, so now you have instant radius dresser, okay, so Eric did a really nice job making this thing, and it's quite nicely made. And anyway, it was cheap. It was $9 or $10. Okay, just one of those random eBay finds that, and I recognize it immediately because Herrig makes one too, but they want $1 million for it. So anyway, Eric, nice job. If you're still around, nice tool making job there, and you get bonus style points for how you cleaned up the end of that. It's just beautiful. All right, you guys want to look at another tool or not? Yeah, let's look at another tool. All right, so this is pretty neat. This was a antique store find, and my wife and I went to Petaluma, and we were prowling around some antique stores up there, and I saw this hammer, And I checked it out, and it was cool, and I just kept going. And anyway, she brought it up, and she says, "Oh, hey, did you see that hammer over there?" And I said, "Yeah, I did." And she goes, "Well, why don't you get it?" And I said, "Eh, they kind of want a lot of money for it." And she goes, "Just get it. You know you want it." So she was right, and so I ended up buying it. Anyway, it was kind of expensive for a hammer. It was $60, but it's a little bit special. So it has a cast aluminum handle and a bronze head, and it's a Proto 1431. Okay, but here's the kind of the neat part. It's from the Indianapolis 500. So to me, that was just kind of special and kind of neat in that. The configuration of this hammer is pretty weird. I don't know, it's about 4 pounds, something like that. And my theory is that they may have used this for, you know, swatting those the knockoffs on the race cars. Or maybe it was, you know, kind of a commemorative. There's no date on it, so it's kind of funny how they did this Indianapolis 500. So there's a little bit of a gap in the middle there, which is a little bit odd, but anyway, just kind of a neat historical piece. So but we'll put it in the hammer collection, and you know, it's been well used, so and I'm not going to be afraid to use it. So everything in here is to be used, not sit on the shelves and gather dust, even though some things do. Okay, pretty neat, huh? All right, this next one, this is pretty cool. So I did some, I don't know, it's not even really horse trading. A guy I know, he's a movie star down in Hollywood. His name is Sam Robertson. And anyway, he contacted me and was asking if I had any secrets for getting a McMaster car catalog. And it just so happened I got a new one. And so we got to talking. So anyway, I mailed him the catalog, and he sent back these books actually. And these aren't from him. Well, he got them from his neighbor, and there's a whole story there, which is pretty neat. So Sam, thank you. This is an excellent story here. So I'm gonna love telling this story from now on. And you'll notice this funny paper on this book here, and there's a whole thing here. So the story is that these belong to a lady, and her name is Florence. What's the last name again? Darn it. Florence Bloom, excuse me. Yeah, I just drew a blank there. So Florence Bloom and her husband Abe lives next door to Sam in Hollywood, California, land of the movie stars. Anyway, Abe gave these books to Sam, but they belong to Florence. Now, what's neat about Florence is that she was an aeronautical engineer, okay? And she worked for a little company down in Los Angeles called Lockheed. And in fact, she worked at the Skunk Works, the Lockheed Skunk Works. So she worked on top secret stuff, which is really cool. So the story just gets better and better, right? Okay. So these are some of her engineering books from when she was an aeronautical engineer at Lockheed, okay? And her career spanned from the 50s, the late 50s, and then she retired in 1988, okay? So she worked on planes like the U-2 and the F-117 stealth fighter. And all the history buffs out there will know that Lockheed put out another plane in between those two, okay? And it was actually the SR-71 Blackbird, okay? So all those planes came out of the Lockheed Skunk Works in that time period. So I'm going to stretch here a little bit and say that Florence probably worked on all of those planes, okay? This is the woman's touch here as she wrapped the, and this is a machinery's handbook, okay? And it's got her name in it, property of Florence Bloom. She wrapped it in, this is actually shelf paper, you know, like you'd line a drawer or a cabinet with, okay? So she put a little cover on her machinery's handbook. And I think, yeah, this one says Florence Bloom. And does this one? I don't remember if this one does. Anyway, it's just a wonderful collection of historical items from a, you know, somebody that Florence, she must have been tough too, okay, to work with all those guys like Kelly Johnson and all those, and I can't remember the guy that took over the Skunk Works. Anyway, there's plenty of books on this, on the Skunk Works. So, and her name may be in them somewhere. I'm going to go back and poke around a little bit and see if I can find anything. But it's possible that that Kelly Johnson borrowed these books from him. You know, his DNA may be on this. Florence's certainly is. And she was, you know, to work with engineers in that time period in the 50s and 60s and 70s, you know, these are a bunch of cigar chewing, you know, cowboys, literally, a lot of them. And so, you know, she was probably pretty tough. And anyway, she worked there for a long time. So it's just a wonderful story. And Sam, thank you for sending that in. And Abe, if you're watching this, thank you very much. I really appreciate you letting us tell the story of Florence here. So, anyway, just a lovely story. Thank you. All right, this next one is really Stone Age. this comes to us from Mark Bracken, and he runs Flintknapping Tools LLC, and he sells rock and tools for flintknappers. Now, you guys might say, well, gee, Tom, what are you doing? You know, you're talking about interferometers and gauge blocks and stuff like that, and now you're talking about flintknapping. Well, you know, these are some of our earliest tool makers here, right, that figured out how to flake stone and work stone into usable tools. And, you know, this is no joke sharp here, okay? Anyway, Mark, he likes watching the show, and he sent in a little box of goodies for me to play around with, because he and I talked on email a little bit, and I've done some flint napping. I'm no expert by any means, but I've made a few points, and it's just an interesting process, you know, how you flake the how you work the stone and make it behave the way that you want it to behave, okay? So it's just kind of an interesting process. So he sent some of his tools in that he makes and sells, and we'll talk about these real briefly here. And then he also sent a box of little Delrin chubs that are left over from making the tools, so which is, you know, this stuff's always handy for little this's and that's, okay? So I'm going to bring in a little closer, and then we'll talk about some of these things kind of individually here. Okay, so what we got here is, got a few things here. This is they call these boppers, and what these are used for is when you have kind of rough, blocky rocks, you can use these to actually strike against the particular features and knock pieces off to kind of knock the bulk off of a raw rock. Let's see if I got a raw rock. So now this is obsidian, and this is chert here, and so is this. This is chert as well, chert. So you can use this to, let's see here. I barely remember how to do it, okay, guys? So there's a spot right there I can knock a piece off. Okay, so you can flake off. Okay, you can knock pieces loose with that. Okay, so that's how that works. And if you're good at it, you can actually do a lot of shaping with these boppers here. Okay. I forgot how hard you have to hit it. Obsidian, you don't have to hit nearly as hard. So, and then what this guy's for? This is a pressure flaker here, and you kind of use it with this pad. You hold this, and then you get in there, and then you go after these individual little spots that you want to do to sharpen it, and then you can do notching like this as well. Okay, you can flake your way in there and make notches like that. So, and then these are abrasive stones here, and you use those to thicken the edge a little bit so that you can control how the flake comes off, okay? And this is just a couple of different grits there, so a little abrasive stones. And then Mark also sent, it's a diamond scribe here, so you can write your name in there and identify these things that you make for yourself. Anyway, it's just a kind of this quiet little, well, I don't know, it's not that quiet, I guess, a little hobby that you can do, you know, and sit there, and it's fun to learn how to control the rock and how it breaks and actually make some neat objects. So, Mark, thank you for sending this stuff in here. This reminded me of my my nasty little collection of stuff here, and it's kind of makes me want to try it again. So thank you very much for sending that in. All right, this next one's pretty cool here. This comes to us from Len Chodaker, and he's a glass sculptor in, where is it? Markham, Ontario, Canada. So he's a Canadian, and he does glass sculptures and glass blowing and things like that. Anyway, he and I have been kind of talking offline a little bit about Polariscopes and using them to show internal stresses in transparent materials, okay? So this is kind of an old engineering technique where you can actually analyze shapes and structures and whatnot and see where stress concentrations are. And so he said, well, listen, he says, I have one, I'll fix it up and I'll send it to you and you can play around with it. So anyway, here it is, he sent it to me. And it has a light source. Then we, at this end here, I'm gonna show you the whole thing. It's got some polarizing films that are clocked 90 degrees to one another. And then he sent me some glass samples, of which this is a pretty spectacular one right here. So. Who has a glass hammer? Well, guess what? I have a glass hammer. I just need some glass nails to pound. Although, glass being as strong as it is, I would not be surprised if I could drive a regular nail with this thing. But anyway, that's beside the point. So he sent me some pieces here. Some are annealed, some are not annealed. And so we can look at the stresses, the internal stresses. So we'll see how this comes up on video, because it's pretty cool in person when you see it. And if you follow my Instagram account, I put some pictures up on my Instagram account that you can go check out. In addition to that, he sent me this before. This is a Meccano wrench, and this is the English version of Erector Set, and which, honestly, this is a superior system, I think. It's just much more extensive. And all the English boys grew up with Meccano instead of Erector Set. But this is an original wrench from a Meccano set, which is, I don't even know if I'm pronouncing that right. Meccano or Meccano? I don't know how you pronounce that. But anyway, there's an original wrench. But let's check out some of these glass samples that Len sent us and see if we can see them in the Polariscope. All right, so hopefully I got it focused here. So let's look at something that's got some stress in it to start with. Make sure, yeah, okay, so that's showing up there. So you see these colors that are emanating away from these cut edges. Those are stress concentration. That's where light is being refracted in a different direction. Because of the way it's cut. Now, I should be able to, let me get lined up here, to flex this a little bit and then they'll change. Yeah, let me rotate that way. Oh, there we go. See, okay, so there you can see it. So as I tweak on this, the stress is moving around in there. So you can use this as kind of an analysis tool, which is kind of neat. All right, and then here's the end where it's been pulled from the other bar, or pulled off of the other bar, okay? So let's look at something else here. Here's another one. And this is sawed and not annealed here, okay? So there's the sawed end, and you can see the stress in that end there, okay? And then this has a little crack in it or whatever that's showing up as a stress concentration. Pretty cool, huh? All right, let's see. I think there's an annealed piece in here. Yeah, okay, so this next one's annealed. So it's been cooled very slowly, okay? And even though the end is chipped there, there's really, looks pretty tasty, no stress. There's a little something there, huh? Anyway, pretty cool, huh? Anyway, Polariscope, huh? All right, let's look at something else here. Let's look, oh yeah, here's another stressy piece. Check that out. All right, let me see if I can put some load on that. This is a pretty big piece. And then the end here, again, pretty wild, huh? Okay, and then, so the coup de grace here is the hammer. And you can see that this has got some residual stress in it from fabrication. Okay. A little bit at this end. Kind of cool though, huh? Just a neat principle. Len, this is this, I could spend hours playing around with this thing. We have a project coming up that we may make use of this with a plastic model of something that I'm going to build, and we can look at the, actually, you know what? I'm gonna turn the auto. Okay, so here's the glass bits again, and there's the business end of this Polariscope here, and there's two polarizing films that have a separation between them. So, and they're rotated 90 degrees to one another, and so, you know, I recommend that if you want to know more about it, you should look it up online. It's more than we can talk about in a few minutes on a video. So they also have these for microscopes too. So to look at crystal structures and actually measure their refractive indexes and their orientations. So it's kind of a neat process, and that's very, very interesting if you're into that kind of stuff. Okay, so Len, thank you very much for sending this stuff in, and I may take you know, he invited me up to make my own hammer on his in his glass studio if I was ever up that way. So if I get to traveling in that direction, I'd certainly look you up. So thank you very much for sending this into the show. All right, that's about it for this batch of meatloaf. I hope you guys like that. And I just wanted to, you know, remind folks that, you know, some of these historical items and these folks that did work back in the day that we learned from, it's important to remember these people. And, you know, by showing their items and their tools on the show here, we kind of preserve their memory. And I'm planning actually a series of special videos that actually really single subject where we dive into somebody's story and somebody's tool. So if you like that idea, let me know in the comments. And till the next batch of meatloaf is ready, I'll see you guys later.